Amen.
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 Hallelujah. Lord, we just lift this day, this morning up to you. We lift our voices. We lift our hearts. We lift our praise to you, God. You have done great things, and you're not done yet. You're still on the move, Lord, and we know that you are here, Lord, and we just thank you, and we praise you, and we pray we bless you in Jesus' name.
Yes, Lord.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed.
Faithfulness,
I'm stealing. The world, but it couldn't fill me. A man's empty praise, and treasures that fade were never enough. And you came along, put me back together.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You're the only one who can. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take Him at His word, just to rest upon His promise, just to know the sin of the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove Him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more. Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust His cleansing blood, just in simple faith to find
one more time. Jesus now.
Jesus now. More than ever. We are sailing in stormy weather. All His children should get together. For we need Jesus now more than ever. For we need, yes, we need Jesus now more than ever.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. We do need you now more than ever. Lord, that song was so applicable because, Lord God, we are in the times of tribulation coming, Lord God. We see it. We see signs and wonders that are happening that Lord God, are prophesied in the Bible that will happen in the end times. And so, Lord, we need you. We come to you. Lord God, yes, you heal. And we thank you for that, Lord God, that you are a healing God. You are a God of miracles. And Lord, we know that we can run to your feet, Lord God, that you provide our every need, spirit, soul, and body. So, Lord God, we just lift up all praise, honor to you today, Lord God, and thank you that we're here. We need you. We need to gather together, Lord God, because we know that your word says we're two or three gathered together. You are here.
Yes.
And Lord God, we know you are here today. And Lord, you're here to meet us face to face, each one of us. You desire for that intimacy, that relationship with us. So Lord, we just come and sit at your feet today, Lord God, and give you all praise, honor, and glory. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Come on, give somebody an elbow bump or virtual hug, a pretend handshake. Amen. 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 Yes. She's just going to stay up for a moment. Yes. Jeffrey went back. Okay.
But I really want a prayer for Jeffrey that he could do good with the lady and for the boy. The boy is in their youth group.
Okay.
He's one of his kids in the youth group.
Yes.
Mm.
Amen. Thank you. Let's all stand together, please. Let's just bring this to the Lord this morning. Father, we know that you're in control this morning, God. Father, Lord God, we don't know exactly what's going on with this boy, but God, we're believing, Lord God, for a miracle. We're asking, Lord, for your touch, your hand to be upon upon the family, Lord God, upon this mother right now. Can't imagine what she's going through, Lord. Lord, and we just pray for Jeff, God, as he is there ministering to the family, God. We pray that you'd give him grace, abundant grace, God. Lord, supernatural grace, the comfort of the Holy Spirit that will bring comfort to this family. And so, God, we just extend our faith, God, our prayers, our hope, God, our trust in you. Lord, we need Jesus even more now today, Lord.
Yes.
Lord, this family, Lord. And, Lord, we all go through these times, Lord God, and we can't always, Lord, we don't know when they're going to happen. So that's why we got to be right today. We got to be right with God today because, Lord, that we're living in turbulent times. Lord, we're living in hard times. But, God, we know that you overcome all, Lord God. And, Lord God, so we're asking for a miracle. Lord, we're asking, oh, God, Lord, that that this boy would be found alive, God. Lord, we're just believing that. God, we're asking, Lord, but if not, God, we know that he's rejoicing in heaven, God. We know that he is born again, Lord. It's part of that youth group there. And so, Father, just let special grace, special mercy right now, God, be extended, Lord, to this family, God. And, Lord, once again, Lord, we just lift up Jeff. Oh, God, what a responsibility. What a, Lord, to be able to bring comfort to a family in this time. Lord, we're not... Lord, we're not able in our own strength, but God, we know that you are more than able to do exceedingly abundantly above all we can ask or think. And so we just pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
And amen. Amen. Thank
amen.
You, Jeff, for letting
amen.
Us know about that.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
We will continue to pray.
Yes.
For Jeff and the family there. Amen.
Yes. Amen. Yes. Yes. Amen. All right. Good morning. Today is our church picnic, all right? So up at Round Hill Park at the Harmony House Shelter. So if you're driving, that's where it'll be. It starts at 3:30 to dusk. And so it'll be good fellowship. All are welcome. If you are in need of a ride, the church van will leave here at 3:00. So be here or be square, okay? You will miss the van. Yeah, be here or walk, all right? And I don't know, by the time you get to Round Hill Park, we won't be there, all right? So each family, we will provide hamburgers, hot dogs, the condiments, water, but you bring your own side dishes for your family. It is not, you know, where you put out a potato salad and we all dip into the potato salad. You know, you bring what you and your family would like to have, and it's for you and your family. So please, you know, be wise about that. Again, wear your masks, you know, social distancing. I mean, we are outside, but we do want to be wise. You know, I just saw on the news this morning, you know, that they're just, you know, forecasting a great spike because of all the picnics and, you know, all these things. So please be wise. We don't want anybody to, you know, to not be cautious. So, again, well, we're excited because we're kicking up our Wednesday night explosion. Woo! All right. This Wednesday, September 9th at 7:00, we will be having girls' ministries up here. We will have Royal Rangers in the other building, the adult Bible study, which has continued to go on, but will go on here. And we are excited. We will be practicing some caution with the kids, and so, you know, masks will be provided, but we also ask for them to wear their own masks. We're asking for social distancing. You know, we're trying to be wise so that families will feel comfortable about having their children come. So again, be in prayer for this because we really feel like we need to come. We need to kick the enemy in the teeth and say, hey, we're coming together. Because just like I said, and you know, when we prayed, two or three agree is touching anything, it'll be done. And he desires for us to fellowship. That's what the word of God says. But we want to do it and be wise about it. So next Sunday, we're also excited because we're kicking back into our other ministries on Sundays. Kids for Christ. Yay! Yes, kids are going to be back. They will be meeting at the youth center. So parents, bring your kids and drop them off at the youth center at 10:00. They will be having breakfast. They will be having games and learn about Jesus. And then they will come back up here at the end of the service for you to retrieve them. Okay? Is that, that's how we decided, right, Michelle? Yeah. Okay. And then also, the Sunday evening, the Unashamed Youth Ministry will kick back in at 6:30 at the Youth Center. So we're excited about that. Yes! So if you have youth, bring them. All right? You know, we are excited to get back into normal, okay? Whatever normal is. But again, masks, social distancing, we are going to have protocol in place. Praise and prayer next Sunday, next Saturday evening at 6:30. We're going to come together and pray and just believe God to be, well, we already know he's on the move, okay? We already know. But all leadership is really encouraged to come because we want to be praying about our you know, just our throwing out all our ministries again. You know, we believe, you know, that no plague will come nigh our dwelling, okay? So we want to believe for that. And then next Sunday is Communion Sunday, and it's also our Healing Sunday. You know what? We set apart that day for healing. But you know what? God can heal today. So he's not a respecter of whatever day. If we believe, it can be done. So on the back, just talking about some ministry opportunities, cleaning the nursery weekly, see Pastor Pat, and then Mary and Martha's Closet down at the Youth Center on Saturdays. Just, you know, a time of if you need in need of some things, you know, Ella has all kinds of stuff down there, clothing, you know, all kinds of things. So, you know, home things. So, you know, come down and fellowship with Ella and, you know, other people, you know, and the proceeds are going to missions and kids ministries. And Ella's phone number's in here. So if you have any questions, you can give her a call.
Going to talk into my water bottle there for a minute. Amen. You know, we've been just want to just give a shout out to those who've been coming out Saturdays, and then I know some others came earlier in the week to help get our youth center ready. You're not going to recognize it. It's still a little messy right now, but we're in the home stretch. Mike, who is not a plumber. So if there's any plumbing issues down there, he claims he don't take responsibility for that anyway. But, you know, we've been doing a lot of, I mean, we have remodeled the bathrooms completely remodeled the bathrooms, and they desperately needed to be done. We have painted the entire sanctuary or in the hallway, and we're getting everything sanitized, everything ready for Wednesday night. And so we're excited about that. Amen. Amen. Are you excited about that? Are you pumped? And so when it's time for us to get started back again with some coffee house ministries maybe and the I know she's there. Okay, and so I just asked her to stay there for a few minutes. But you know, what was I saying? Coffee house ministries. You know, I mean, that building is really used by everyone, and so we're, you know, just really excited. So thank you so much to our youth leaders and Mike and Regina and others that work with the kids. Thanks for coming down, Emery and Linda. If I forget your name, please forgive me. But it takes a lot of people just to make this happen. And so I think you're really going to be happy to see what the youth center looks like. Okay, and so. Right before we get into God's word, I asked Debbie if she would just lead us in that chorus. Anybody recognize that song that we sang this morning, that last one? No, that was a Jimmy Swaggart song. Have anybody ever heard Jimmy Swaggart? Okay, he's got that country Jimmy Swaggart kind of do. I'm not sure if we did it exactly like him, but it was close enough. It was pretty good, but it's the words. You know, when we look at the chorus, and I got the wrong page here. Here it is. Well, maybe I had the right one. I had the right one? Okay. I got two in the book of Revelations here. Okay. Where's the chorus?
On the bottom. Jesus now more than ever.
I got Jesus now. I don't have that. I got two pages of page two. Where'd it happen to it? Oh, jeez. It'll be where? Oh, up on the screen. Thank you. And where? I want us to sing this because, you know, we need Jesus now more than ever. And there, you know, this has been tough on a lot of people, this coronavirus, for these last 6 months. And we're believing that we're seeing through the end of the tunnel. And that's why we, why we believe that we need to get started back up as a church again. Okay. Yeah. And we're doing it as safely as we possibly can. But we just really feel that we need to. Oh, I have it right here. It was underneath. There you go. Wow. And so I just feel that it'd be, you know, we are sailing in stormy weathers. And it seems like, wow, the last six months have been kind of stormy, haven't they? You know, and so, but all his children should get together. And we know that, you know, we're going to reengage in church and it's going to take time for some to come. And we understand that. And please don't ever feel that we are, you know, condemning those that feel that they just need to stay home for a little longer, okay? We understand that, and we're praying for you, and we trust that you're watching this on Facebook. But we need to, you know, we need to get together, don't we? We need to get together. Okay, we were created for fellowship, and, you know, we were created to be a body of Christ, okay? And so, for we need Jesus now more than ever. And maybe that's not, maybe you don't maybe need Jesus now more than ever, but I believe that there are some in our church family that does. You know, I believe that there are some that are home or that they really need maybe him more than ever. And it's been a long time without fellowshipping and feeling like you're stuck in your home or something like that. And so can we just stand? And Debbie's just going to lead us in that chorus. And can we, as we sing, we're just going to sing it through twice. And can we just, as you're singing it, intercede, pray and sing at the same time. And just let's lift up those that really do need Jesus more than ever. And if that's you, then that's great. Okay. Amen. So let's do this. Let's sing it. Go ahead.
Jesus now more than ever, we are sailing in stormy
Hallelujah.
Weather.
All his children should get together, for we need Jesus now more. Come on, let's just lift our hands and sing it one more time.
Jesus now,
yes, more than ever,
we are sailing in stormy weather.
All his children should get together, for we need Jesus now more than ever. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. And God, we confess our need. Hallelujah. We confess our need for you, Lord. We need you today. And we especially lift up those, oh God, who need you even more now than ever. God, that you would just touch them and comfort them. God, we just give you praise for that. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Okay, we want to pray for Pat Daniels this morning. Father, we just bring up Pat Daniels to you today. God, we just love her. She's a part of our family here, and God, she needs you, Lord. But you know, we're not going to go into the specifics. I'm not sure if she would want that, but we want to respect her. But Lord, we just lift her up to you, and God, we know that you're able to meet her need. Oh God, touch her, God. Just be strength, God. You are our rock, God. You are our fortress, oh God. We come to you, Lord. The righteous run in, and they are what? They are saved. So, Father, just be there with her, Lord, in this thing that she's going through, Lord. And we just bless her in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen. Now, Lord, now open our hearts to your word. God, let us have hearing ears, a hungry heart for your word. Amen. Amen. Sorry about that. Kind of said amen, and then I really wasn't ready for amen. But I guess amen says, so be it, so let it be done. And you can be seated, okay? Amen. You know, we're in a series on the renewed mind. And there is no doubt that this is there is a battle going on in the hearts and minds of God's people, and I see it all the time. I mean, the enemy doesn't really have any new tricks. He's not creative. Satan can't create anything. He can only take what has already been created and mess it up. Okay. And we really need to be praying for the body of Christ. You know, we have people come and they receive Christ, and they're really trying to get their lives together, and it's a struggle. You know, I just remember when I got saved many, 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 many years ago. I wish that it would happen that I am born anew, my spirit, but I wish my mind was also born anew. I wish somehow or another that my mind could just kind of, like Etch-a-Sketch. Anybody remember those little things you used to? I was never very good at those things. I mean, I couldn't, I could wiggle the knobs around, but I really couldn't make anything that you could recognize, okay? But the wonderful thing about it, that no matter how bad it was, you could what? You could just etch it out. And oh, wouldn't it be wonderful that if when we come to Christ that we could just take our minds and just take all the bad stuff, all the stuff that is really tied into the things of the world, the things that have been twisted, and that we could just take them all. I'm going to keep some stuff reading. I don't want to have to read again. I want to know about certain things, but those things But that's not the reality. But I have good news for you today, because God is a good God, and he's got a plan for your heart and your life. And no matter how difficult that it might be, that there is a way for us to live the life that he wants you and I to live. And so if you got your Bibles, Romans 8:29, let's get into God's word today. I really believe God's got a word that will just bless and release and encourage. And so let's just listen and let's just hear what God has to say, because I believe I'm speaking to many here that are also watching this morning. Welcome. We're glad that you're checking us out on Facebook. Romans 8:29. This is a great, we always look at 8:28, but we never look at 8:29. 8:28 says that he works all things for the good. Amen. That's great. We just love that, okay? But really, it's tied into verse 29. And so I just want to focus in on 29. For whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Now, I want you to hear this maybe for the first time. Maybe you've read this many times and kind of you read your Bible and you kind of glaze through it. But listen to what it says. For God has predestined you to be conformed to the image of his son. You know, when people connect to Jesus, things began to change. My life changed when I gave my life to Jesus Christ. It did not completely change. There was still a lot of stuff that was there, but my life changed when I gave my life to Christ. You know, he loved me as I was, but he didn't leave me as I was. Amen? Anybody catch that? You know, he loved me as I was. You know, I didn't have to get my act together. I didn't have to become religious to be saved. No, I was a sinner. I needed to be saved. He loved me as I was, but he didn't leave me as I was. Amen. Aren't you so glad that he don't leave you like he found you? All right. No, he doesn't do that. You know, and so, you know, change isn't easy, but listen, what this verse says, it is God's will for your life to be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ. It is his will. Did you know this, that the Christians, you know, we talk about vision and purpose and meaning of life and all these different sorts of things, but let me just tell you, according to God's word, that your primary purpose in life is to be like Jesus. Now, that might shock some of you. Well, wait a minute. I thought it was to be, you know, to succeed and to be successful and have lots of money and have all the things that I want. No. You know, that might come along with life. But God's primary purpose for your life is that he had predestined you. He has a purpose. And his purpose is that what was lost in sin, through sin, by sin, is regained in Christ. And that he has predestined that every, meaning it's his purpose, his destiny. Do you see the word destiny in that word, predestined? That it is your destiny, it's God's destiny for your life to become like Jesus. Okay? And so, well, how do we become like Jesus? Well, that's what we're talking about. You know, it's becoming like Christ. It's why we're called Christians, after all, isn't it? All right? And when you have this purpose secured, if you understand this is your primary purpose is to be like Jesus, then the good news is that everything else, those houses and cars and careers and jobs and all the things that we think is our primary purpose, which they're not, they're really secondary, but then they actually make more sense. You understand that life makes more sense. Your career, your life, your house, the car, whatever. All the pursuits of life, they make more sense when you got this purpose first. Okay? Because if not, then these other things will always be crowding to move into first place in your life. And we know that to be true, don't they? Don't we? You know, we know that very true. These things will seek to take first in our lives. But God's will is that he would be first for whom he foreknew. Now, I'm not saying, you know, we get into predestination, and I'm not getting into that. You know, we think that God already determines who's going to be saved and not saved. That's not really what he's talking about here. You have a will. You have to choose Jesus Christ. Amen? Okay? But because he is all-knowing, he knows everything, but in his knowledge doesn't mean that he does the choosing. You understand? Just because he knows everything doesn't mean that he makes the choosing. But this is what he is saying in this verse, that those he foreknew. You know, he knew that you would be here. Actually, do you know that he knew that you'd be here this morning? That you would be here listening and being engaged and worshiping God and even singing that song that we just said, Jesus, I need you more than ever. Okay? He knew that you would, that you are a born-again believer this morning. Does that mean you're perfect? No, because none of us are. But he knew that you would, that somewhere in your life up to this point, that you would open your heart to Jesus Christ and receive him as your Savior and Lord. He knew that. Now, he didn't make you choose it, but he knew that you would. Amen? Does that make sense, what I'm saying? And so when he talks about this here, for those he foreknew, he knew that you would be saved, and this is his will, that he predestined. His destiny now for you is to what? Is to now become like Jesus. Because when you're like Jesus, man, life gets a whole lot better, okay? It really, really does, okay? And some of us could probably even testify to that, right? Okay? So that word predestined, you can see another word, that word destiny. It is your destiny to be like Jesus. Oh, it sounds like Star Wars. Sounds like Yoda. Oh, no. That was the Emperor, right? Who was telling Luke, it is your destiny. Well, you know, the devil wants to sell you a destiny. You see, the devil would even be happy if, you know, the devil would be happy if God's not, you know, to put something else, and he would be okay with God being second in your life. Because he knows that eventually, something's going to have to, that he's going to be even lower than second. Okay? The word there, conformed, it's the Greek word, and I don't mean to impress you with these words because I can't even pronounce them, but this one here I can. Suma, morphos. You hear the word morphos. It's not metamorphos, morphos. Morphos means to what? Metamorphos does, not this word. Okay? Sum, okay? And so... You got me all flustered now. What in the world she's talking about here? Got me messed up. Sum is to take on another form. To take on another nature. Okay? It's very similar to the word transformation, but it's a little bit different, or a person or a thing. In other words, is to be like Jesus. Okay? You know, why does God, listen to me, why does God want you? That is his predetermined will. And because it's his predetermined will, can you imagine that he is going to help you? If he has predestined you to become like Jesus, don't you think that he's going to provide every possible way? He will, because it's his will. He wants it more than you do. Okay? But why? It's his greatest joy. It'd be your greatest joy. And number two, it puts you in a position to really impact the world for Jesus Christ, okay? And so, what is God's will? You know, the best definition that I have found for God's will, if you got your Bibles or you can look at the screen, is in Matthew chapter 6. It's in the Lord's Prayer. This is the best definition of what is God's will for my life. What does God, and I'm asked that a lot, what does God, this is God's will, this is his overall will. Now we know there's lots of little things that go along with that. As you go along your life, you want to know God's will about whom you're going to marry. You want to know about God's will about, you know, what kind of career or where am I going to live or something like that. I mean, we need, but the overall will, the purpose of what God has predestined you is in the Lord's Prayer. And it's more than just words. It really talks about the priority of life. He says, in this manner, therefore, pray, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done. Now, let's just jump back to where it says, your kingdom come. That simply means that you let your dominion come. Let you reign over me. That's his will. Number two, the second part was, let your will be done. And then he defines what it is on earth as it is in heaven. Well, that's a kind of a crazy definition of what God's will is. Boy, you got to understand what Jesus is saying here. You know, that any area of your life, and we're talking about the renewed mind, your thoughts, attitudes, lifestyles, behaviors, goals, pursuits, ambitions, whatever, that do not mirror heaven is inferior to his will, and he wants to change it. Okay? In other words, that, you know, is that we don't have to wait to go to heaven to experience heaven now. God reigns in heaven, right? God wants, and where does God want to reign? He wants to reign here in your life, so that what is on earth is in heaven. In other words, he wants heaven to come down. You know, we need to bring the atmosphere and the things of heaven into our life. And this is what Jesus is saying. You know, it's not hard. Listen to me. It's not hard for God to get you and I to heaven. Did you hear what I just said? It isn't hard for God to get you and I to heaven. He sent his son. Jesus Christ. All we need to do is what? Believe that with all of our heart. Repent and believe. And what? Man, I'm born again. I've received the adoption, the seal of the Holy Spirit, the promise of the completeness later on. It's not hard for any of us to get to heaven. You know what's hard is getting heaven in us. That's what's hard. It's not hard getting you and I to heaven. You know what it is? It's bringing heaven into your life. Bringing your life into conformity to God's will. Where is God? God is in heaven, and God's will, he wants to bring his will into your experience, into your life. So if God says it's his predetermined will for you to be conformed to the image of Christ, to become like him, then it would be foolish for God. God never tells us to do something without providing the means to do it. If God says it's his predetermined will, you are predestined to be conformed to, well, I can't. No, I can't. No, I can't. No. I can't. I try. It just don't work for me. Is this what we hear a lot?
Yeah.
And which really you are what? You're telling God, you don't know what you're talking about. And God says, well, I know what I'm talking about. The problem is right here. The problem is your mind. The problem is how you think. The years and years that we've been indoctrinated, in a sense, in the things of this world, the spirit of the world that is at work in the sons of disobedience, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 2. And so, you know, I've tried to do the right things. I try to think the right things. And, you know, it seems like the harder I try to think the right things, I think the wrong things. How about you? I mean, some of the harder I try to think right, I think wrong. And then, what even, you know, I try to read this book, you know, I'm talking about this book, and I can get about a half a page, and then I just, this doesn't make any sense. You know, and then the problem is that we can't change what needs to be changed is your mind. That you're trying to, many people are trying to follow Jesus with an unrenewed mind, essentially. The years and years of life, the years and years of thought patterns and values and the ways of your life, your habits and et cetera, they're, they need to be changed, okay? They need to be changed. And that's what Paul says is the renewing of the mind. And that's where much of the battle that every single one of us go through every single day is that we're battling in our mind ingrained thought patterns that leave to lead us, okay, and they've become so frequently that we visit them that we create a pattern, and we don't even have to think to go there. We immediately, our mind goes there. You know what I'm talking about? You know, I why do I think that way? Because you thought that way for so long that it becomes just, it's part of your nature. Well, see, we have to create a new nature, and the nature is part of your soul. Your soul needs to be what? Sanctified. Your soul, your mind, your will, and your emotions need to be changed. And so how am I changed? And that's what we want to talk about. How do I, you know, change, you know, how can I bring my life into conformity to Jesus, okay? Well, it's going to be according to your mind. In Romans 12:2, let's look here. We're going to look at several different verses. But let's look here first. And do not be conformed to this world. Now, we see that word conformed. We see it again. It's a little bit of a different word. It's not the exact same word that we just read about. I'll explain that in just a minute. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed, Okay, that's that metamorphosis that my wife was talking about earlier. Metamorphosis. There are great examples in nature. What reflects the physical reflects the spiritual, the caterpillar and the butterfly. Inside every caterpillar is a what? There's a butterfly. It has to shed the cocoon. Okay? We have to shed the cocoon. We need to shed the world, its thoughts, its values, its meaning of life, how it deals with life. Okay? Because the world's got its own little thing going on, doesn't it? About how it deals with life. And deals with it from A to Z. From anywhere to obsessive compulsive alcoholic workers who live for nothing but the dollar bill to the alcoholic who lives in the gutter. A to Z. But it's all influenced, the Bible tells it, it's all influenced by the spirit that is at work in this world. You need to memorize Ephesians 2:2. And you begin to recognize, why do I think the way I do? Why can't I think godly thoughts? Because so as a man thinks, Proverbs, so he what? Or she is. Or how their behavior follows. Okay? Your body never took you anywhere that your thoughts did not go there first. Your thoughts paved the way for you where you ended up at. So where, if you don't want to end up where you continually end up at, what do you need to change? Your thoughts. And we can only do that through Christ. And I'm not saying you can't do that. Okay. Maybe some of us to a degree, but most of us can't. We need the help of the Holy Spirit. And if God said that I've been predestined to be conformed to Jesus Christ, then there's possibility for every single one of us to be exactly that. Stop making excuses. This is the biggest obstacle for a renewed mind. Excuses. Oh, I was born that way. You know, we even get into, we can get it where I'm Irish. You know the story about Irish people, don't you? You don't know the story about Irish people? We're all a bunch of drunks. And so we kind of, you know, well, I come from a long line of whatever, excuse. In my family history, I come from a long line of professional alcoholics. Okay? And so I was destined to be one myself. And you know, it happened until Jesus came. And then Jesus said, you know, but I can renew your mind. I can change you. Because, you know, for if you are in Christ, we are what? A new creation. The old is gone. Now, you need to understand, it just doesn't, you know, it just, you know, there is a process there in 2 Corinthians 5:17. You know, we just say, well, the old is gone and the new has come. Okay, I'm new. No, it's a process. But the truth of the scripture doesn't change. The old can be gone and the new can come. And how does it come? My friends, you got to understand, if you don't change your mind, you'll never change your life. If you don't change the things that you think about, and you can change that. And I'm not saying it's easy. I used this illustration last week and I'll use it again about thoughts. You know, thoughts are like, you know, when you have, if you have a nice little green yard, let me take my neighbor's, Bob's got a beautiful green yard. You know, if I were to walk across from A to Z and draw a line and walk across and continue to keep walking back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, eventually I would what? I would create a path. Right? I mean, that grass would die. His beautiful green grass. And maybe I would follow, okay? I'm not sure, I think. But anyway, he's a good guy. I'm praying for him. But I would create a path, the pattern. Do not be conformed to the pattern of the world. That's what the pattern of thoughts, okay? We create those pathways in our mind. They're neurological pathways. Yeah. I mean, something happens in my life, and all of a sudden, boom, that's where my mind goes. The phone rings and fear. Oh, I want my kids. And so, to create a new path, you got to what? You got to get off the old one, and then you got to what? Start making a new pathway. You do that for a while, and you go back and look at an old path, and you know what you'll start finding? Your grass is growing again. Things come back to normal. And so I'm not saying it's as simple as that, but this is what this verse is talking about. And so he says, do not be conformed to this world. And there's a long definition, long thing about what that word conform means, but it's simply in patterns of behavior. And these patterns of behavior have been, are just simply things that have been established much, maybe even in your early childhood. Let me give you an example. But you have a baby cries and tells you what? Well, baby's crying and you go to it and you feed it because it's hungry. And so after a while is that the baby associates what? Crying to what? I need mama. All right. Well, the problem is 10 years later, you know, 10 years later, child wants something. Mama says no. Child goes, ah! Ah! And then what does mama do? Yeah, take it. See? Yeah, we establish those things even very, very young. And so these, it's do not be conformed to the pattern, to the thought way, to the values, to the meaning of life of this world. Because there again, what's Ephesians 2:2 says? For the spirit of the prince of the air, the spirit that is at work in this world, and the sons of disobedience. And all of us were disobedient until we came to Christ, and even afterwards. And so be not be conformed. But then it goes on to say, it says to be transformed. And that's the word metamorphosis. And the word comes from metamorphosis. Okay, simply means to it's changed from the inside out. In other words, what's inside of you now? When anyone is in Christ, he is a new what? Creation. Christ is in you. And so what does Christ want to do? Does he just want to stay locked up in your heart somewhere? Does Christ just want to say, hey, I'll see you when you get to heaven. Bye. Good luck. Christ wants to what? He wants to change your life. He wants to what? He wants to change the form, the nature of your life. And how is it done? He says it can't be any more clearer. How does transformation take place? By the renewing of the mind. It cannot be any clearer. If you want change in your life, you have to start changing. You got to change your mind. And that's the decision that you will have to make. But a decision that, guess what? God will support and he can help you. And matter of fact, he will help you. But you need to make the choice, but be transformed. Morpheus. 2 Corinthians, turn there, 2 Corinthians chapter 10. This is the second verse we're going to look at, and we're going to look at one more verse this morning, and then we're going to close. This is powerful, powerful verse. Oh, geez, because this speaks of the realities of what is going on around you, that you may not see it. You know, we're not privy to see the spiritual warfare that is going on around us, because I think that's by the mercies of God, that you don't see what's really going on in the invisible spiritual world that we live in. It is the mercies of God that we don't look up and see, I mean, demons and angels clashing and battling and you know, and amen. I wouldn't want to see it, okay? I mean, it would freak me out. It'd be enough to put me underneath my bed in my bedroom and not want to come back out again. But that's not God's will, is it? So we're not, you know, there's things that but we live in a spiritual world, do we not? Come on, look at the TV. I mean, just look at what the nonsense, the crazy stuff. You know, not just the crazy stuff, but the spiritual stuff that is going on. There's a spiritual war going on. And that war is also, you know, I'm sorry to say, you're a part of it. Because you're in this world, okay? We're not to be of it. But we're in this world, but we're not to be of it, but we need to overcome this world, because you still have an enemy who prowls around like a lion seeking to devour you. He wants Jesus to become last on your list of your priorities. He wants Jesus to be a distant memory to you. You know, he doesn't want you to think about Jesus when you go to work. He wants you to get around your buds and your pals and start talking like them, acting like them. Yeah, you know, they go out for lunch and have a few beers, but you want to, hey, yeah, that's right. I can do that. That's cool, because I left Jesus back at home anyway. Right? Well, I can, meet up with, meet up and, whatever. I can date whoever I want, whatever. It just goes on, and so, 2 Corinthians 10. Let's look here. It says, verse 3: For though we walk in the flesh, that just simply means you got a body. Anybody, come on, pinch yourself, remind you. Oh, that's right. I got this body. I got this bag of bones. You know, it's not sin. It's not evil. It's just the reality that you have a physical body. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. Well, I'm not at war. Well, verse 4, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, fleshy, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds. What are strongholds? Where do strongholds, where are they at? We're going to tell you where they're at. They're in your mind. That's why you can't control yourself. That's why every time something happens, there's a trigger, and immediately your mind goes to that. Men, whenever you hit an opposition or hit something or life or whatever, immediately, pornography, boom! Because that's where you've gone to find help and relief before. You know, or it's the drug, it's the alcohol, or it's you just indulge yourself more into whatever. Okay. Strongholds, and they are real. They are very, very real. But it says that these strongholds that have dominated your life, and there's some people in this room, you've been dominated much of your life by various strongholds. Fear. Fear is a stronghold. Okay. Worry. Not being enough, not being good enough. And so, see, there's an answer. See, because you'll never, God has predestined you to be what? Conformed to the image of Him. And His will is whatever on earth is on earth as it is in heaven. I may tell you, they got no fear in heaven right now. You know, they're not running off to the bar to try to deal with their, I got to get the edge off. I got to take care of the edge. Life is, I got to take care of the edge. You know, you don't need to take care of the edge in heaven. And God is saying, you know what? It can be that way on earth too. On earth as it is in heaven. Now, we're almost like a utopia sort of thing. And I don't think any of us are going to experience it absolutely completely. But, oh, there is so much more that we could have. The abundant life. What I'm talking about is the abundant life, isn't it? Jesus said, I've come to give you life, and I come to give it what? Abundantly. You know what abundant life is? On earth as it is in heaven. Can it get any better than heaven? Do we have to wait to die to experience heaven? We got to deal with the strongholds that are in our mind. We got to deal with the thoughts, the patterns. Listen, keep verse 5. Casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Bring in every thought. You know, I remember when I got saved. I really didn't know this scripture, but even though I didn't know it, I was practicing it. And then it made sense when I finally discovered it. Oh, there it is. Well, that's what I'm doing. And then I began to realize when I start looking at a war, and I thought I was the only one. I thought I was demon-possessed sometimes because I thought it should all be new. I ain't new at all. My spirit, I'm born again. God lives in me, but there's still much of me that is still what? Man, you know, I thought Jesus just took that all away. You know, and much of my life he did, so I don't want to minimize my conversion. I mean, the alcohol, the drugs, oh, man, that, praise God, you know, because it had such a stronghold upon my life that he delivered me. But there was the, just my mind, you know, and just taking thoughts, just I take that thought. I can't think that way. Stop it, you know, and whatever scripture I would know, I would just speak, in which I knew very little, of course, as when I first got saved, but take every thought into the obedience of Jesus Christ. You know, a sinner, we need to do that. Do you know that the word repentance, you know, the Bible tells us, and just give me a few more minutes and we'll wrap this up. You know, the Bible tells us how we get saved. But it even tells us more what happens after we're saved. It really does. You know, the Bible, even though it's really the story of redemption, but it's more of the story of life lived for God. That's what Paul talks about, okay? We are saved. The Bible tells us that we need to repent and believe. Repent and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you shall be what? Saved. You know what the word repent means? Change your mind. It's meta, which is the word change. Metamorphosis, changed form, changed nature. Meta-nomen. And it's two words. Meta, which is means change. Nomen means mind. Repent. Jesus says, for the kingdom of heaven is near. And it's not only just changing our mind about how we get saved, but is life actually becomes, you know, repentance is just not a one-time deal. You know, actually what we're looking at here in Romans 12:2 about the renewing of the mind is continual repentance. That's what it is. It is continual repentance, not of being born again. Because when you're born again, you're born again. But now that I'm born again, God wants to bring a metamorphosis in my life, which is a change of form, which comes by a change of mind. And so therefore, any thought or anything that comes into my life, into my mind, that is not God's will, I need to what? I need to repent. I need to change my mind about that and reject that thought. You know, recognizing patterns of thinking and contradiction to God's word. And most of us really know, but we don't apply then the word. You know, we don't apply what can bring that into obedience. So the result of the renewed mind, you know what the result of the renewed mind is? Look at the last phrase in Romans 12:2. And you will be able to prove what is the what? Good, pleasing, and perfect will of God. In other words, you will be able to prove on earth as it is in heaven. You see, and only until you really get committed, really get down to earth about dealing with your mind, instead of making excuses for it, instead of whatever, you know, just saying, well, that's how I am, that's how I was raised, you know, I'm Italian, or I'm Irish, or I'm something or other, I come from a long line of alcoholics, you know, I come from that, you know, this is just how I am, this is who I am, like it or not, this is the way I'm going to be. Well, Jesus says what? It isn't the way that you have to be. No, because if you come to me, I'll change you. You know, I not only change your location after you die, but I'll change your life now. I'll bring transformation in your life so that you can literally, I mean, begin to live on earth as it is in heaven. Wouldn't it be? We can have a little bit of heaven on earth, eh? Amen. You know, we were talking about the Bee Gees the other night, okay? You know, no one gets too much heaven anymore. You know, that's the truth. Because what? We don't understand where it comes from. And the Bee Gees didn't understand. Heaven comes from God. And we can have it. We can have it daily in our lives. And you know, the tragedy is this here, that many believers just repent enough to get saved, but not to see God's will done in their life. Did you hear what I said? Can I say that again? Many Christians repent enough to get saved, but not to see his will done in their lives. And let me tell you, repentance is part of the Christian life. I find myself repenting, well, I shouldn't say this, but sometimes dozens of times a day. Because my mind can just go into all kinds of things. My mind can be, you know, I could be watching something on TV and all of a sudden, my mind, I repent of that. I take that thought captive. I'm changing my mind. I will not think upon that. You know what you did when you just did that? You repented. That's literally what the word repent means. Living a life of repentance. So how do we renew our minds? Take one thought at a time. And bring that thought into obedience. Bring it into the obedience of the word of God. I believe that whatever your stronghold is, whatever your thought problem is, you need to get a scripture so that when that thought comes, you got a scripture that you can immediately apply to that thought. You understand what I just said? I'm kind of giving you some real good stuff here this morning. You're kind of acting like, well, I don't really like this here, whatever. You got a problem with your thought life if it's cursing. You got a problem with your thought life with purity. You have a problem with your thought life and addiction. Whatever it might be, whatever that battle is within your thought, because that's how the devil gets you, right? Every single, don't tell me it doesn't, because I've been there myself. And when that thought comes, when all of a sudden you're just like, you can just feel your blood pressure come up. You can feel the stress level comes up. You can feel the worry and the anxiety start coming up. You need to have a scripture. Boom! Pull that scripture over and say, I take that thought and I take it under obedience. God, bring peace into my world, because there's peace in heaven. I can have peace right here on earth. When there's no joy and the joy of God and whatever the circumstances that rob the joy from you, we walk around joyless and just sad and depressed and whatever things that trigger that. Our way was what? Oh, everything's terrible. Blah, 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 blah. But our new way is what? We take that and we bring that thought into obedience and say, with the joy of the Lord is my strength. I can do all things Jesus Christ. Now, don't beat yourself up if you forget to do it a couple times. But guess what? You keep doing that. You keep doing that over and over again. And you know what you're doing? You're creating a new pattern for your life. You're actually being what? Transformed. You'll begin to start. You'll be amazed how, man, I'm, you know, don't get too prideful about this now, okay? Pride cometh in the fall, okay? But, man, I'm doing good. Man, I haven't thought about that in 3 hours. 3 days. That's change. Amen? Hallelujah. We can really, really experience heaven on earth. I believe it's God's will that we experience heaven on earth. Now, I know there's a level of it that we're not, okay? You know, because, you know, but there is so much that we can, for God predestined that you what? Could be conformed. You think Jesus walked around the earth? Oh, I don't know what I'm going to do with these disciples. They're always messing up. But Jesus, Father, what? You know, you think Jesus walked around worried and, you know, he had to tip into the bottle of wine a little bit to get the edge off? No. You think Jesus needed that? Come on. And we're to be like him. We're to be like him. You know what? I know what comes to my mind immediately when I hear that. Well, that was Jesus and I'm me. There again, see, that's that excuse that immediately comes up. Oh, that's Jesus. That's not me. And yet God's will is that what? It would be you. And what's keeping it from the reality of it becoming you? Is your mind doing the battle in the mind, winning that war in the mind, defeating the enemy in your mind? Hallelujah. God's word is good. Amen. Amen. You know, I mean, we just need one last verse, I promise, Galatians chapter 3. We looked at this a couple weeks ago, but we're going to finish with this verse. We're just about. Robin asked me, hey, are you done? I said, I think I probably can't give them any more. They probably won't be able to handle any more. So I think I better just stop where I'm at. Okay? Galatians chapter 3, verse 1. If then you were raised with Christ, woo, what does that mean? You're born again. The only way you can be raised with Christ is to experience death, okay, and resurrection. When you get saved, you experience the death and the resurrection of you. You died and you rose again. Amen? As a new believer, a new spirit of God born into you. If then you were raised with Christ, seek those things. What do you seek? Honestly. You know, what consumes your time when you are thinking about things? Seek those things which are above. How in the world can heaven ever come into my life if I never seek? Really set my eyes. That word there, seek those things, or set your eyes, fix your eyes. Hebrews 12, 1, you know, or is it 12, 2? It says, fix your eyes upon Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. Seek those things which are above. I mean, do you earnestly really have a time daily? I'm not talking about weekly, daily, that you really seek the things of God for your life. How are we going to be transformed in a world that is constantly bombarding you? And the world is. You can't get away from it. It's everywhere. Turn the TV on. It's right there. Go to work. Bam! And some of you, I mean, it's really there, okay? You know, family. I go visit my family, and bam, it's there, okay? Whatever, you know, we just live in this world where we're just constantly, the world is seeking you. Do you know that? Satan is seeking you through the things of the world. It isn't Satan himself, because he's got the world in such a way that you know, that much of the world, come on, just be honest, okay? It is ungodly. I mean, you really need to pray for our kids that are in school, they're in colleges. My goodness, they're in the worst, they're in literally hell itself sometimes, really. What they're being taught, what they're being told. My goodness, I got a middle school granddaughter that they're mandatory, they need to read stuff about lesbianism. Mandatory reading. And then the teachers are encouraging them. And we wonder then why. You know, my goodness, we got little kids, boys and girls that are 10, 11, and 12 years old, and they think they're gay already. They don't even know enough to know whether they're gay or not. Those thoughts were planted. Those thoughts came somewhere in their lives. Man, but we can't isolate ourselves from the world, can we? No. We got to overcome it. And we got to teach our kids how to overcome it. And we got to teach our people in our church how to overcome it, because our mission is the world. Right? It's the world. When you understand that your primary calling in life is to be like Jesus. And when we put that somewhere down on our list and it's not number one, let me tell you, then things are going to start breaking down, and we wonder why our kids are running off and doing all kinds of crazy stuff. And life is, you know, it's just, you know, I really believe that in many ways we weren't made for what's going on. Do you know that when God made Adam and Eve, he made them for the garden? He made them for like a heaven-like experience. Do you know that? Their soul was not equipped to deal with the sin, the debauchery, the lawlessness. And neither is yours, and neither is mine. And then we wonder why our minds, man, I am just sometimes at awe at some of the things I can think. And as soon as I start thinking I'm getting somewhere, boy, another thought comes to remind me, oh, I need you, Jesus. Oh, I need you, Jesus. Jesus, help me with my mind. Seek those things that are above. Those things that are in heaven. That's what he's talking about. On earth as it is in heaven. Set your mind. Let's go down. What's verse 2? Seek those things which are above. Set your mind on things above. Not on things of the earth. And some of us, I guarantee you, we put more thought into some of the things of our lives and our dreams and our ambitions than we ever do with God. Boy, can you just imagine what could happen if you could just reverse that? If you could just make God number one, and then, oh, what God could use and what God could do then with everything else. Whew. You know that God can take everything that he's given you and he can amplify it and use it to a level that you just don't understand. But we think it's for us. Everything that God has given you is really, it is from him. But we can take those things that he has given to him and we make them idols. We make those the things that we serve. Well, see, as God, what he has planted in your heart and what you're doing for him in the various areas of your life was not meant to trump him, but it was meant to come under him. And when it comes under him, then he can anoint it. You understand what I'm saying? I mean, he can anoint that and use it to ways that we can't even fathom. When we begin to understand that all that we spend so much time and fuss and worry and energy and life and resources, and yet we spend so little time seeking the mind of God. You understand what I'm trying to say this morning? Our minds need to be changed. Hallelujah. Praise God. Would you stand with me, please? I want us to... Now, if you're here this morning and you're just feeling condemned, I hope you don't feel that way. Because we've all, you know, I want you to be challenged this morning because God loves you. And I would not want to ever do anything that would discourage you or say anything to discourage you, but I will say that what's on, I believe that's on the heart of God. Your mind. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want to lead us all in a prayer this morning, and this is kind of how we're going to close. I'm not going to, just really felt this morning, I just was in the office over there, and I just really felt just as I began just to write down. I usually don't write prayers out, but I wrote a prayer down. And I really felt this is what the Holy Spirit would have us do this morning as we really. I know that there's people in this room, including myself. Oh, I know you want to be like Jesus more than anything else in the world. And yet you find it the most difficult thing in the world. Matter of fact, to the point where many get discouraged. And this is typically the number one reason why many people stop walking with God. Because see, man wasn't created to fail. We were created to succeed, to win. And when we can't win a battle, when we can't win at a sport, we'll go find another sport. If we can't win at one thing, we'll find something else we can win because that's our nature. And when we can't win, excuse me for using these words, but I think you know what I'm talking about. When we can't win in the Christian life, and when we continually fall, continually are just held captive to our thoughts and just, you know, it's damaging. Even to the point that many will walk away from God because they say, you know, that don't work for me. My friend, let me tell you, it is His will. It works. It works. The mind. And I believe it begins within your heart. And so this morning, we're going to make a heart confession that it is my heart. It is my desire. Wherever happened before you came here this morning, that right now it is my desire to honor you. Lord, it is my desire with all my heart, my soul, my mind, Lord, to live for you. And I need your help, Lord Jesus. I need you, Lord. But I want you to sing the chorus with me. I want you to sing this chorus with me. It's a song that we sang many times. If you don't need to look at the screen, don't look. Just close your eyes and just sing this with me. Lord, I give you my heart. I give you my soul. I live for you alone. Every breath that I take, every moment I'm awake. Lord, have your way in me. See, it begins with that decision. And God, that we're going to take the thoughts, we're going to take those thoughts, and we're going to bring them into obedience. So let me just tell you, whatever your strongest thoughts are, whatever your strongest thoughts are that lead you to where you don't want to go, I want you to find Scripture. So that when those thoughts come, you bring that scripture and you put them on an index card, you put them on your phone, something that is readily available, that every time that thought comes, you pull that scripture out. And hallelujah, I take captive that thought in the name of Jesus. And then you read that verse out and you say, take that. Hallelujah. And every time that happens, let me tell you, my friend, you keep doing that. I don't care what the stronghold is. I don't care how long it's been there. I don't care. God's word will break that stronghold over your life, and you will find the victory. Hallelujah. You will begin to experience that heaven on earth. Amen. In your life, you'll begin to see your mind being changed, your life being changed from glory to glory. Come on, sing it with me one more time. Lord, I give you my heart. I give you my soul. I live for you alone. Every breath that I take, every moment I'm awake. Lord, have your way in me. Now, before I pray, I just want to say, I want to just have this on Facebook Live so you can look at it later. Four things you need to do. Get into the Word of God. You need to daily repent. If you need to repent every single day, take those thoughts and bring them captive. Come on, watch the people, places, and things in your life. Come on, be careful about those things, the people, the places, the things that are in your life. And then get into the presence of God. 2 Corinthians, that we're changed from glory to glory in the presence of God. I want you to reach your hands in such a way that you would receive a gift. Come on. And however how way that you would, if you to reach your hand out, God's going to, and I'm believing that God's going to touch you this morning. So reach your hands out in a receiving way, like you're receiving a gift, and ask the Lord right now, Lord, help me with my mind. Hallelujah. Now, I want you to be specific right now. Not think of 100 different things, but think of that one thing. That one thing. Come on, think of it right now. Do you have it in your mind? Now ask the Lord, Lord, give me the grace to sift my thinking, to change my thinking, to see and to think with a renewed mind. Hallelujah. Come on, did you do that? Lord, come on, say, Lord, I'm asking you, God, Lord, this thought, Lord, this where it takes me to places I know you don't want me to go. God, I'm asking you, Lord, for your grace and for your help, Lord, that when that thought comes to mind and when I bring the word of God, Lord, that you will be there, that you will help me, God. I will see a shifting of my thinking. Hallelujah. Put your hands on your head. Will you do that? Come on. Put your hand, one hand on your head and pray with me. Lord, I'm asking. Come on, every single one of us. Lord, I am asking for the renewing of my mind, the renewing of my eyes to see your will, for the renewing of my ears to hear your voice. I am transformed by the renewing of my mind. I will be able to prove God's perfect will in my life. A renewed mind is a transformed life. And my mind is being changed through the power of God's word. Come on, we're not talking about positive confession. We're talking about through the power of God's word, my mind is renewed. In Jesus' name, Lord God, I thank you, Lord. Lord, I pray now, Lord, that this word will not return void, but Lord, it will accomplish all that you have purposed it, Lord, in Jesus' name. God, the reality is, And maybe we don't want to talk about it. Maybe we want to talk about a little lighter things, a little bit more happier things, you know. Oh, how blessed and how whatever life, you know. But, Lord, the reality is that there is a battle going on. And, God, we need to be equipped to deal with the battle. And the battle takes place in our minds. And so, God, we thank you for your word. We thank you, God, for your word. Lord, you have not just left us hopeless, defenseless, helpless, God, but you have given your great word, oh God, Lord, that breaks every chain, that breaks every stronghold, Lord, that can change my mind. Let me tell you, my friends, and you don't have to look at me, but I'm telling you, if God can change my mind, and I'm not perfect, I'm not the poster boy of a Christian, come on. I don't want to give you any sort of false reality, but let me tell you, boy, where my mind is today and where it was, God has brought me so far. And it's because that he has helped me to renew my mind. And he will do the same for you if you desire. You got to long for this. You got to long. You got to desire it with all your heart. And he will change. Oh, those dark things, those dark places where our minds go and where our feet take us, God wants to change. Oh, through his, and it brings him glory. Oh, he wants, and you know what? It brings joy into your life. It brings joy into your life, doesn't it? Come on. Hallelujah. To be pleasing to the Lord. Doesn't it bring joy to him? It brings joy to you, but it brings joy to him. To be pleasing to him. Oh, hallelujah. So, God, I just, Lord, anything that has been misconstrued, Lord, I denounce it right now in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord, we just submit to your word this morning. Let it be done. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Now, Father, once again, Lord, we want to pray for Jeff. We want to pray for this child, Lord, for the family. Lord God, we're looking forward to hearing good news, oh God. Let your grace, let your mercy, God, let your compassion be there, Lord. The comfort of the Holy Spirit. Lord, as we gather later on this afternoon with our picnic, Lord God, we just pray, we just thank you for this beautiful day that we have and for the time and the fellowship that we'll have with each other. And we pray all this in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Lord bless you. Have a great, 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 great day. Amen. God bless you.